Hello, this is Carl's coaching. We're glad you're here. We're testing out our new Yeti microphone. So if it doesn't sound right, let us know. If you know of ways to make it sound better, if you've had experience before, make sure and comment somehow and let us know how we can make it better. But Laura's here with me.
Hello.
And we just got to see two of our daughters, or our only two daughters, but two of our children this weekend. So it's been a good weekend. Got to see our new grandbaby and so we got to spend a little more time with her. So pretty good weekend overall. Just sitting down to talk about millennials today. And millennials is a topic I noticed, at least a lot in social media, that people talk bad about them. For the most part, lazy and all kinds of things that we want to label them with. I think a lot of that comes from the fact that they're different. They're not exactly like we were, the generation that came before them. And I think in the long run, that turns out to be a good thing. They're making new paths, and we certainly could use a new path right now. But my experience with millennials is nothing scientific, or I didn't do years of research, but we were raising our kids, which are all between about 21 to 26. Is that right?
Yep, that's it.
21 to 26. So they're in that category. Most of their friends we're in that category, and we had some interaction with some of them. Some of them were our friends, so we got to see them. But before we start into that, maybe we could talk just a little bit about being parents, and Laura can chime in here anytime she wants to. But I started out, and I would guess that most of you have similar parenting experiences, and you're either there or just been there or was there a long time ago, but you probably had similar experiences like me, that you started out, I think you start out just wanting them to do some things like you, speaking and doing things and holding their spoon. We watched our granddaughter starting to eat a little bit of solid food this weekend, and so you kind of want them to mimic you. But sometimes into I hope they do things better than me. I hope they're a better version of me, and they do just a little better. Or maybe I didn't have opportunities, and I want them to have those opportunities, and I want them to outshine me. And sometimes we can try too hard at that stuff, don't you think, Laura?
Yeah, I think so. I think it also just starts even when Holland was, newborn, just in her short six and a half, seven months of life, deciding who she looks more like, her mom or her dad, so we even go back that far as far as who does this child look like. So yeah, I definitely agree with that.
And I think some of the mistakes that I made as a parent was when I wanted something too much for them, or I wanted them to accomplish a sports goal or an educational goal, and I wanted it more than they did, and that caused some struggle between us. And I think if you're not careful, it can cause some real issues. But they eventually kind of found their way, and as teenagers, it seems like we kind of lose control. We lose some control. Based or independent, whatever you want to call it. But we lose some control, and that can make us feel kind of helpless. Like this project that we've invested all of our lives, or 15, 16 years into, where it feels kind of like it's slipping through our fingers. We can feel helpless. with it. Realize we're not going to get Dad of the Year if there ever was something like that. But I think through that frustration of losing control and being frustrated and struggling, that you at some point just realize, hey, this goal is not to make super people. It's just to help develop another human being, and I'm thankful I get to be a part of it. And when you kind of rest in that, you start to get comfortable. And this is really not about parenting, but it's just kind of what sets up what I'm going to talk about. Hopefully at some point then we become at least friends, if not good friends. And I think don't you think that's happened with our kids?
I think so. I think it's getting there, you know, more so as they get older. I think they turn to us more for advice, and they can leave it. But yeah, for sure, as they get older, I'm grateful for that.
Yeah, a lot of people say that when their kids get older, that they get smarter, and the kids, kind of like Laura said, come to you for advice. But I think the most amazing thing to us was that as our kids got older, we actually started to learn from them. And they in some ways pioneered areas for us that they taught us. And if you're not prepared for that, it can be a little frightening. Like, you know, it just doesn't seem right, and you want to fight that. But if you take long enough to listen to them, sometimes I think that you actually learn from them. They're starting to experience the world in a way that I might have shut off because from them. They're starting to experience the world in a way that I might have shut off because I'm set in my ways, or I'm comfortable, or just don't want to change. But they've gone through different experiences, either in high school or college, that challenged them and caused them to grow. And some that challenged them and caused them to grow. And sometimes they'll grow in spite of you, and we learn from them. You find that also
to
be true.
That's true. Yeah.
So today we're talking about millennials. The four subject areas are millennials, and I don't know how profound they are, but they're significant to me. And as we've kind of progressed, and I've watched our children and their friends, these are the things that kind of stick out to me. Social media has its own opinion. The armchair quarterback, so on, of the world like to repeat things about millennials that they've heard. But I always ask those people, saying that millennials are lazy, for instance, I said, you know, all of the millennials that I know work a couple of jobs, and they always have, and they don't seem to be sitting around doing nothing, for instance. And they'll say, well, yeah, the ones you know, of course, are. And I say, well, I just want to start from my own framework. When I was writing these down, I wrote down what I've noticed, what I've observed in my world. Could be different for you. We'd love to hear that. We'd love to talk about that. If you can comment and give your own opinion.
I think there's a lot of destruction in categorizing any class of people, for lack of a better term, as one thing, as all being one thing. So to say that, I mean, number one, that's not true. But number two, I mean, there are people that are our age that, you know, could be classified as lazy. So, I mean, the idea is that in any category of or generation of people. You know, there's definitely people of all types. You know, really, really hard workers, and people that, you know, we would consider lazy, whatever that means to you. So I just think there's a danger. All millennials, or most millennials, are lazy, or whatever adjective you want to use to describe them. I just think that could be dangerous.
Yeah. So. Yeah, and so maybe even what we're doing is dangerous too, but hopefully we keep it on the positive side. And I did print this as a blog, and so it's been out there for a while, and I asked some of the people I know to look at it, and they agreed with it. I don't know if that means anything or not either, but so let's just go through these. These are the things that I've noticed, the things I would say that I've learned, that that means anything or not either, but so let's just go through these. These are the things that I've noticed, the things I would say that I've learned, that they help me learn from millennials. And the first thing may sound kind of backwards, but it says they are less certain. And at first, I think that sounds like a bad thing. One of my daughters kind of explained it to me. She said, we were talking about, I think, religion. And she said, when they have discussions, when millennials have discussion, they might end up with an idea. And to my generation, that's frightening. When we admit, whether we admit it or not, we have a deep need for certainty. We want to know what's wrong, who's responsible, and what we're going to do to fix it. And we've developed that do to fix it. And we've developed that maybe from watching sitcoms that solve all our problems in 30 minutes. But I've noticed that millennials seem to have a higher tolerance for uncertainty and mystery. And they listen to podcasts that are, she listens to one that's generally 3 hours long. And I just almost have a hard time imagining that. But these podcasts have several people on them. They talk about issues, and they may have different opinions on that issue, and they don't really resolve the issue always. They don't always resolve it. They just end at the end with differences of opinion, and they're okay with that. My opinion, my generation's made a lot of mistakes with certainty. The way we discuss politics is we say, I'm right, you're wrong, now politics is we say, I'm right, you're wrong, now shut up and sit down, or if you don't like it, leave. There's a big thing that my generation likes to say. We forget that even the Bible has some uncertainty and some mystery in it that requires trust and faith. So when we think we make mistakes because we're too certain, we're not open to new ideas. We're not open to looking at something a different way. The things I think I understand, I'm too certain about those. And then I don't learn or grow, and I'm not hungry.
Yeah, uncertainty is scary, really. So, but if you're not willing to take that risk and ask questions, you know, honestly, you're kind of stagnant. You're really not giving yourself an opportunity to grow. I know as a teacher, I encourage students to ask questions, and we always tell little ones, you know, oh, there's no stupid questions, you know. And yet as we grow up, we lose that and wonder,
mm-hmm.
just wonder,
yeah.
you know, about stuff.
That's right. So to us, certainty sounds like something golden. To a millennial, that doesn't sound like anything good at all. And I've noticed in my life recently that the need for certainty can actually hinder me. And in some ways, I'm better not to be so certain about everything so I can grow, certain about everything so I can grow, and be challenged and listen to other people's ideas and things like that. So they have less certainty. The second thing I noticed, and this is probably pretty obvious, that they are less judgmental. I think to have control. When we see things in our world that are don't make sense, or things that are troubling or chaotic, things that aren't going our way, we like to control. So judgment helps to control. So judgment helps us control, but control is based on fear. So something happens, we're afraid, so we control it. But fear is something God repeatedly encouraged us not to do. All throughout the Bible it says, fear not. Over and over again, fear is something God asked us not to do. So, but judgment is also something Jesus encouraged us not to do. And most rational people understand that, but we still do it, and we force for doing it. That we just, it's just a part of everything we do to judge everything in our life and people. It goes along with kind of certainty in a way, because when something goes wrong on TV, we need to know who's responsible. On TV, we need to know who's responsible and what are we going to do to fix it. So we make a judgment. Usually, if there's a serial killer or something like that, then we want to make a judgment right away about why that person did that, and we want to fix that problem or control it so that we won't have fear anymore. You find that to be true?
Yeah, right? That's what I was going to say, that it seems like certainty and judgment kind of go hand in hand. So, yeah.
My children have taught me to express my beliefs and then just leave it at that. And I think that has helped in analyzing things, because I'm not too quick to try to say that I know, or say that I know about you, or so we've it's helped me kind of sort things out. So I can say, this is what I believe, but not, this is what you should believe, or maybe even worse, saying, this is what I believe about you. That's definitely judgment. I'm discovering that even in the matters of faith, there are mountains of things I don't fully understand. And if I'm going to be authentic, I can really only say that this is what I understand to be true. And I hope that we can journey together. And living authentically in this way requires making this a practice, not just a wish. So I think the millennials are proving that can be done. That we can be less judgmental. And it doesn't mean we're any less holy. In fact, it might mean we are more so, because Jesus said not to do it. So,
well, what if we just started a conversation? I recently watched a, it was really a church service, but they sat down and they talked to a Muslim, I don't know what they're called, but it's like they're the Muslim pastor, for lack of a better word.
Mm-hmm.
There's a name for it, an Islam. And it was amazing to me, you know, how many similarities there were. I mean, yes, there were some differences, but just how they were able to just have a conversation without degrading or judging or condemning the other person. You know, they realized they were going to disagree on some things, and would the Christian pastor love to have converted the Islamic pastor? Absolutely, and vice versa. But, you know, they remain friends, and they're so I just think that, you know, how often do we do things like judge, you know, before we even take time to sit down and have a conversation with somebody?
Hmm.
We might realize we have a lot more in common than we truly ever thought with millennials.
True.
I think we just make a lot of, like you said, we just make a lot of judgments about them without really even, or we've had an encounter with one or two, and so then all millennials are like that. I mean, we just, as a human being, we just have a tendency to do that.
And I think the, just like children, the things that we would like to convince them of and change them because of our fear, and again, it's fear and control, but we'd like to change them, and so we often, that's the one thing we're focusing on and judging them about. May not understand their position, and it might be a lot better not to judge them, but to say, help me understand.
Right.
Help me understand your position. Where does that come from? Where did you arrive at that decision? I know that's very hard, because especially on social media, when we're, someone defies us, or, you know.
Yeah, social media is probably not the best place to have your conversations with someone. I mean, I don't know. I have a love-hate relationship with social media, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just because so much destruction can take place because you don't have to look somebody in the eye.
Yeah.
You know, you can say things you probably would never say to their face, but.
Yeah.
Anyway.
But in general, I've seen millennials just have a lot less judgment in them, and I think that's a good thing, and they're proving that it can be done, and proving you can still live a life and not have to judge everybody that you meet. So the third thing is they are less needy, and this may contradict what you've heard, but. When I would complain about someone not understanding my positions, one of my daughters would say something like, "Don't get your validation from other people." And I kind of thought, "Are you kidding me?" Because that's where I get all of my self-worth from, is from other people, from what people say about me. I mean, isn't that what is big in our time has been performance appraisals at work? So performance appraisals are so I can feel worthy enough to face another year. I need somebody to tell me what I'm worth. And we might call it worth or value or appreciation, but it's all the same type of elusive self-esteem that we rent out to other people. We just want them to tell us. Even with podcasts, we want somebody to like it or leave a comment or tell us that it was good, just to validate it. And I think sometimes that gives us problems. But at least to some extent, they're a little less needy. I've heard, you know, that from birth, the millennials have heard, you know, you can do anything, and there's a lot of positive affirmation that's been given them, and the thought is that maybe that spoiled them, but I don't seem to be less in need of that affirmation. They tend to do what they think is right, kind of handle it on its own merit. I think what they get upset about is not injustice necessarily towards them, but they get upset at injustice towards others. They're pretty sure where they stand. They don't need you or I to validate them as much as to have an idea or a mission. So we all want to be brave, but sometimes bravery is simply the courage to stand alone. And I just want to say I see that a lot in millennials, that they have a little bit more courage to stand alone. Their courage may not look exactly like ours, but they do have like ours, but they do have the courage to stand alone. And according to Brené Brown, that's important. That bravery, that courage to stand alone, is what makes you authentic. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All good on that one?
Yeah.
All right, the last thing, this has been a huge thing for me. This has been a thing, I think, that my teenagers, the teenagers in my life, I should say, have been people that taught me to be more compassionate. The reputation of teenagers is always, no matter what generation you live in, the reputation of teenagers is always that they don't care about anything. But that's not true, because teenagers care deeply about things. It's just not the same things always that we care about. And they may not care about taking out the things that parents care about, but they do care about things, and they care about specific things. As we progress in life, the things that matter change. As my children began to mature, not only did I realize they cared a lot about things that matter, but in many cases they cared a lot more than I did, and that kind of humbled me.
Mm-hmm.
That they cared about. And I can just tell you about the people in my life, but the people in my life cared a lot about disenfranchised people, and I can't say that I've always cared about that, but I think they've helped me care a little bit more about that. But people, people of color, people in different situations than I am, they've just helped me have a lot more compassion. You might just take a look at who's fighting for the minimum wage worker, or the immigrant, or the marginalized. Usually it's those terrible millennial kids, you know. And even though I was a pastor, I don't think I set a very good example for my children in this area. I think my generation was too self-made to realize we were part of a community. And I think that's what millennials understand. We often protect our tribe, but we fail to realize the world is a community.
It goes back to certainty. I mean, it just goes back to, you know, those things that are foreign to me. Are they going to affect my feeling of safety, my feeling of security, my feeling of certainty? And I think when that happens, then certainty. And I think when that happens, then, yeah, you are less likely to be compassionate toward people that may be struggling, that maybe aren't part of your tribe.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, this weekend is just, you know, Jesus never asked us, he never came so that we would separate and segregate ourselves from each other the way we have, all for the sake of, you know, certainty or safety or whatever. So, that's a big thing. Compassion is a big, you know, I always thought I was a very compassionate person, but my kids have definitely opened my eyes to a lot of things that I was actually not being very compassionate towards. So, it's been a good.
I don't remember exactly what Brene Brown says, but it's something along the lines of, if it's hard to hate someone up close, something
mm-hmm.
like that.
Yeah.
And when you lean in to people and get close to people, then it's a little harder to hate them. Maybe that's a lesson for the millennials. If having a hard time understanding them. Might make sense to spend some time with them, some time trying to understand. I think most of them know where they stand. They're not afraid to tell you. So anyway, I'm grateful that the next generation has concern for animals and the environment. My generation has performed pretty atrociously in this area. We've assumed that it was either ignored. Things like the environment. I think the next generation has realized that unless they do something, the health of the people and the planet and the animals is in jeopardy. And it's not really as much about activism as it is personal responsibility. I think that veganism, environmentalism, and responsible agriculture is definitely going to be trends of the future. I'm really not an expert on anything, and I'm not claiming to be an expert on millennials, but I'm just a guy that notices stuff, and Laura and I try to learn, we try to read, and try to be open to new things. But I don't think I'm wrong about millennials. Maybe that's a judgment, but, and there I go being certain again too, right? But we're on the cusp of a major shift in religion and politics and world affairs. I think there's got to be some things that change pretty quickly, and I think they will. But we just want to kind of give a thumbs up or give our shout out to and our hope that they really do change the world, because the world needs to be changed. It's not in good shape right now, and it could use their help. So, anything else to add?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
I'm excited to see what the future holds.
For sure. Remember, you can look up carlscoaching.com. Online, it's Carl with a K, carlscoaching.com, at Carl, Carl's Coaching on Twitter. And this podcast, I don't know how you found it today, but it's available on iTunes and Google and through Podcast Addict and I guess several of those things that feed into that. But we're glad you came along. The thing we would love most about this is not necessarily for you to tell us it was a good job. The thing we would love most is if you would comment somehow. If you'd send us an email or comment below the podcast on the website, or just respond in some way. Because unless we have a conversation about these kind of things, we're headed in the right direction with that. But you may not agree, and you should say so if you don't. Just send us a little note, and let's keep the conversation going.